Hello, I'm Kristen Oakes White.
And I'm Avery Davidson. Thank you for joining us for This Week in Louisiana Agriculture, the only TV show bringing Louisiana farmers and consumers together every week. The damages to both human life and the economy from the pandemic are still being calculated. Louisiana alligator farmers are one group that was severely affected.
As Twilight's Nima Lawson tells us, this homegrown original not only helps the people in the state, but has driven the recovery of one of the most iconic animals in Louisiana.
Here at the Vermilion Alligator Farm, it's time to return these babies to the wild. It's all part of the alligator industry's sustainability, which has helped grow the population from under 100,000 to more than 2 million alligators today. Inside the facility, these luxury skins are headed to overseas destinations for luxury brands. Even with all these unusual factors, it's just like regular farming, according to Steven Sagrera.
When we started the farm, I believe my dad started with roughly 250 animals the first year. And then over the course of the next 20 years, grew it up to that, you know, 70,000, as much as 80,000 animals on the farm in a given year. And it's a very cyclical, it's like cattle, it's farming, right? It's a very cyclical market. You get very high prices for two or three years, and then the crash comes and you have very low prices for several years.
The alligator industry has faced some setbacks recently. The COVID pandemic has crushed demand for skins. Normally, they process 60 to 70,000 skins a year. Past 2 years, they're down to less than half that.
What we're experiencing now with COVID-19 and with the pandemic, very depressed prices. Basically, the market just stopped. We had something very similar in 2009. That we went through, but that was just a financial crisis, so everybody kind of knew how to handle it. This is a little bit different. It's a little bit tougher.
Here, Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries officials make sure that every tag is correct and registered. Similar policies are in place worldwide.
We're regulated, you know, from the time we collect the egg to the time we sell the skin overseas. I mean, there's steps all along the way that are monitored by U.S. Fish and Wildlife and or Louisiana Wildlife and Fisheries.
The public-private partnership isn't just about keeping the industry above board. 10% of all alligator eggs must be returned to the wild as adolescent alligators, well past the age when they suffer high mortality. That means the industry and the animals in the wild thrive.
So annually, we give farmers permits, they collect eggs, incubate them, and when they come up, we come up with a hatch rate, they return 10% of what they've hatched at 48 inches long back to the wild. It's a sliding scale, so if it's slightly higher than 48 inches, they have to put back less. Slightly lower, they put back more.
The requirement for returning alligators to the wild size-wise is 36 to 60 inches, and she's a good one for surviving to help propagate the next generation of alligators, making this industry sustainable now and in the future. Reporting from Mouton Cove, Louisiana, I'm Neoma Lawson.
Of course he had to hold one. Of course he did.
He knew he would. The moment he said he was doing a story on alligators, you knew there was going to be one in his hands. And at least he didn't bring you back one, right?
I would take an alligator handbag or a belt or boots or something, Neil. But fortunately, sales of alligator skins are starting to resume as businesses are opening back up. It's good news for Louisiana and for the alligators as a whole. You can find more pictures and some funny outtakes on our website at twilighttv.org. Well, alligator sauce piquant was on the menu at the second annual party at the Big Red Barn in Vermilion Parish.
The event, organized by the Vermilion Parish Farm Bureau Young Farmers and Ranchers, raised money for the Vermilion Parish Farm Bureau Dwayne Zonbrecher Scholarship, the Louisiana Farm Bureau Foundation Linda and Wayne Zonbrecher Scholarship, and the Louisiana Ag in the Classroom Foundation. Organizers say those are high priorities for the Vermilion Parish Young Farmers and Ranchers.
Half of the proceeds are going to go to our Dwayne Zonbrecher Scholarship because it is our parish scholarship, and we're trying to fund it as a four-year scholarship instead of just a one-year scholarship, which is how it's set up now.
It's so important for students to start learning about agriculture at a young age
because everything we do revolves around agriculture, and it's just so important that these students learn this.
The event raised more than $50,000 for the foundations. There are more Farm Bureau fundraisers coming up, including the Terrebonne and Lafourche Parishes Farm Bureau's Fishing Rodeo. That's in Grand Isle on June 9th and 10th. You can learn more by going to our website at twilighttv.org. Summer Produce offers a bountiful selection of colors and flavors to add to your dinner plate, and they're healthy too. That's one of the big things there. From squash and zucchini to tomatoes and cucumbers, I'd have a hard time picking my favorites because I eat them all.
Me too. This week, Twyla's Carl Wiggers takes us to Holden, Louisiana to meet a couple who have found a creative way to bring their fresh produce to market.
Under the yokes that line the Amite River, you'll find the Riverside Farmers Market, which has an eye-catching mobile market filled with veggies from this couple, Susie and Jonathan Poche, or as they're better known online, the Farmer's Darling.
I am the darling.
Darling, the farmer's darling.
I am the darling.
Susie gets credit for the name, but she makes sure to give Jonathan the credit for all the hard work.
He knows what needs to be watered, what needs to be fertilized, whatever. He knows how to do all that. I know how to say, okay, look, this is how we need to, let's take this picture this way. Let's post this. Let's do this. Is it going to be worth it to do a box giveaway this week? Okay, let's do it this way. And so we balance each other out. So we have our leeks, our spring onions, pickler cucumbers, green beans, zucchini, our golden glory, which is a hybrid of squash and zucchini, tomatoes, cabbage, red potatoes, patty pan squash, and our cue ball squash, and our red onions, and butternut squash.
They bring those boxes with them to drop off locations or also to the farmers market every weekend, like this one here in Port Vincent.
I saw this as an opportunity to reach more of my customer base out here that couldn't meet us at 9 o'clock in the morning for our boxes.
Instead of bringing a tent and a table, he just pulls up, opens the doors, and everybody comes in and does their shopping.
People love the concept of it. I mean, people come on the bus just to see it. It's definitely one of a kind.
Jonathan says the favorite part of his day is when he's out in the field.
Growing things, watching things grow, which I enjoy the most, seeing how it grows. Just trying different things out, and I mean, it's like a big experiment every day.
I'm Carl Wiggers for This Week in Louisiana Agriculture.
Now you can find the Farmer's Darling, and they're hard to miss in that bright yellow school bus, every weekend at the Riverside Farmers Market in Port Vincent. To see where else you can find a school bus full of produce near you, head over to our website at twilighttv.org, and we'll link you over to their Facebook page. Another veggie you can find in season right now, banana peppers. And if you have a plant, you may have more than you can eat. I know this all too well from personal experience.
I remember when you were trying to give them away so much. If that sounds familiar to you, this week's Ag Minute is for you. This week, our friends at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum show us how to pickle some banana peppers for some pickled pepper goodness.
Hi, I'm Liz Williams here from the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. We're here for your Ag Minute, and today we're pickling banana peppers. Have peppers in your garden. This is the time that you're going to have way too many of them. So anything you can think of to do with peppers is really, really a good thing. So first, we're going to take the banana peppers that have been sliced into coins, and we're going to place them into a mason jar. And then, once we've filled this and we're ready, we're going to add some seasonings to our boiling vinegar. This is boiling. We're also going to add some sugar, let it mix, and then simply take the boiling vinegar and pour it over the pickles. We're going to add the lid, let it cool a little bit, and put it in your refrigerator. These are not preserved, so you can't keep them all winter or anything like that. But in a few days, they'll be ready for you to eat and enjoy.
Seems pretty simple. I may have to go out and pick a peck of pickled peppers myself this weekend. To learn more about the Southern Food and Beverage Museum, head over to our website at twilighttv.org. Still to come on Twila, we head to Church Point, Louisiana to get some fresh Louisiana crawfish.
Then Twila's Jennifer Finley brings it back to the kitchen to cook it up in a savory salad with a Baton Rouge chef in a brand new Field to Feast. Stay with us.
Hi, I'm Gert Hawkins. I'm a director with Louisiana Land Bank. Louisiana Land Bank employees really take care and cater to their stockholders. They put people and relationships first. I grew up in a farming family, and the majority of the employees with Louisiana Land Bank come from a farming background as well. They really understand the needs of a farmer. I know if I need help, I can get a person on the phone. If you're thinking about purchasing land, call Louisiana Land Bank.
Landowners are minding the Louisiana forest for our grandchildren, a place for wildlife, recreation, lumber for homes. It's the right thing to do. Forestry, covering half our state, all of our hearts.
I'm a farmer.
I am a farm wife.
I am a cowboy.
I am a grass farmer.
I'm a businesswoman.
I'm a conservationist.
I am an advocate.
I am a voice for Louisiana farmers.
I'm always learning.
I'm a husband.
I'm a mom.
I am a dad.
I'm a granddad.
I am a consumer.
I grow the food that feeds your family, and I'm proud of it. I am Farm Bureau.
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 We are Farm Bureau.
Welcome to Field to Feast, where we profile Louisiana and its local ingredients. This beautiful morning, we are in Church Point, Louisiana with David Savoy. We're going to try some of his Cajun classic crawfish, bring it home and cook it up with Jay Ducote.
Field to Feast with Jennifer Finley is brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board, Louisiana Crawfish, ask before you eat, and by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council, beef, it's what's for dinner, and by the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board, think rice.
My name is David Savoy. I manage this family farm and a peeling operation. We are about 5 or 6 miles out of Church Point going towards Eunice, and this is the center of where we do our work.
Talk to me a little bit about what makes your crawfish special, unique, delicious.
Okay, as far as the operation we have in the field, it's pretty much the same for everybody. There's a few quirks here and there, but we process here, we cook them faster, and we freeze them faster than most people do.
Last Saturday, they caught how many?
302 sacks, a little over close to 10,000 pounds.
10,000 pounds, and then tell me how many they're going to peel in there per day.
They peel roughly 400 and something sacks a day.
Like 50 sacks a person?
Yeah.
Wow. But they take a lunch break.
They take a lunch break.
And they don't eat crawfish on their lunch break.
No.
Probably not.
They don't
want
to see a crawfish on their lunch break. This year was probably the strangest I've ever seen. It looked, with all indications, it should have been a banner year. We got the rains. It stayed wet. You would think crawfish, wet, yeah, that's gonna work. Then we get a freeze at a bad time. I think it killed possibly a generation of crawfish off, and it hurt, it held back. We're finding that everything is roughly a month late, maybe a little bit more than that, and we're seeing a lot of crawfish right now, but we're over the hump as far as time goes. You know, we have this month, next month for good production. After that, the production in the farms is not that great. It may be, people want to get out of it. It's too hot. It costs too much money to keep your water levels. So it's not, it's economical would be the best way. We're in this like everybody else to make money. And when you're taking money, grabbing it in this hand, giving it to the diesel guy or giving it to the electrical company, it doesn't pay anymore. So that's what happens, you know, May, June. It's just too expensive to keep the operation afloat. So that's why the crawfish, more or less, we're out of it at that point, and we have to start getting ready for next year.
David, how important is it for the people of Louisiana to eat local?
It is extremely important. I always say if you're looking for crawfish, call a farmer. Ask them. That's the way you're going to get it the freshest and usually the best. I try to give people that come and buy crawfish from me the best stuff I have. I want you bragging about what you bought. And the only way we can do that is to treat you, you know, like an original customer, which you are.
And now that we've learned all of his secrets on what makes this crawfish so delicious, we're going to take a sack over to Jay Ducote and cook up a delicious dish. So stay with us.
It's a well-known fact that here in Louisiana, sugarcane is more than just a crop. It's a way of life. It creates more than 16,000 jobs across the state and an additional $3 billion boost to our state's economy. And Louisiana's cane families always give back to the communities where we live, work, and play. Louisiana sugarcane, making life sweeter, naturally.
Sugarcane, sweet sugarcane.
Louisiana oysters, salty, sweet, and delicious. But have you ever thought about what happens to all those oyster shells? Most of them end up in trash cans and landfills. The Coalition to Restore Coastal Louisiana is changing this with its oyster shell recycling program. And you can help by visiting these participating restaurants. It's a simple and delicious way to restore our coast. The shells will then be used to sustain and rebuild oyster reefs. Remember, once you shuck them, don't just chuck them.
Jason, let's go see your room.
No, that's not right. How is it? Is it good?
Church Point, Louisiana, with some of this Cajun classic crawfish. And we're here with Jay Ducote, our local celebrity chef, and he is going to fix up a delicious dish for us. What are we going to be doing today?
We're going to do a fried crawfish tail salad with my Louisiana molasses mustard. So this is going to be a fun salad to put together, really easy for anybody to do it at home, and we're just going to whip it up and have fun in the kitchen.
I have never had fried crawfish tails.
That,
I am so excited.
To me, it's crazy.
I know.
So the first thing we'll do is our salad dressing. I've got some Greek yogurt here, and then I have a little olive oil. I have my Louisiana molasses mustard.
Look at that.
So this you can find all over town, jaydecote.com, lots of local supermarkets and things along those lines as well. It's kind of like a honey mustard, but it's sweetened with Louisiana cane syrup and molasses, and it has a little bit of Tabasco and cayenne on the back end. So it's sweet, tangy, spicy, works great as a marinade. It's just awesome in all sorts of sauces.
All those flavors sound absolutely delicious. It's almost close to a barbecue sauce meets a honey mustard.
Yeah, that's right.
Yummy.
Yeah, and so most stores you can find it actually with all the other barbecue sauces next to JD's Louisiana barbecue sauce, but the molasses mustard is so good.
So good.
And then I've got some lemon juice here. So again, we're making a salad dressing to get things started. Greek yogurt, olive oil, Louisiana molasses mustard, and lemon juice.
It's always good to make a salad dressing for a salad when you're about to fry something to put on top of it.
Uh-huh.
It's all about balance.
That's exactly right.
What a pretty color.
Yeah, so just something. Oh, yeah.
Mm.
That's going to work. A couple other ingredients that I want to chop up. So I've got my orange bell pepper. So I got enough red onion there.
Pretty.
All right, so these greens I got from Fullness Organic Farm. And these things are just absolutely delicious. This is
so pretty.
A salad mix that they have with all sorts of different lettuces that they grow.
You can taste how local, how fresh that is.
And then this is some fresh mint.
Did you grow it yourself?
Nope, this also came from Fullness Organic
Farm. Oh, did it?
Man, it smells
delicious
as well.
Later on, we can have a mint julep with it.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good idea.
Oh,
I'm
going
to add some of that to the salad as well. I'll get back to that in a second. Right now, I've got my Cajun Classic Crawfish Tails, and I have some flour and corn masa, which is just a really fine corn flour as well. And now I've got crawfish tails. And these crawfish tails come packed in that fat as well, and so they're pretty wet, so you don't really need to do a dry, wet, dry batter, or you know, a wet batter. You can really just kind of go in to the seasoned flour with all that moisture that you want. You can kind of see all the moisture at the bottom of that bowl.
Like, I'll tell you what, we spent the
it's
day.
It's okay for the crawfish to be in that.
We spent the day while they were getting all of this prepared to send us with this to give to you today to cook. And I tell you what, that operation was unreal.
All right, I'm gonna drop this in my hot oil. It's at 350 degrees Fahrenheit right there. Put this aside. I'm gonna wash my hands real quick, and then we'll focus on putting the rest of the salad together.
Sounds good.
So I've got that greens mixture that we put together earlier, and I've got all my chopped bell pepper and red onion.
It's really like a piece of artwork. When you're doing it right, it just pops with all of the colors.
I wanna add just a touch of salt and pepper, so I'm going back to my JD's Backyard Brisket Rub, which really is just my blend of salt and pepper. And then we've got this salad dressing that we whipped up. And this is that Greek yogurt, olive oil, lemon juice, and JD's Louisiana molasses mustard.
Oh my word.
So.
This looks so delicious.
Put in a little bit of that, and then we're gonna toss it all together.
I cannot wait to try my first fried crawfish tail.
And we'll put some of these
greens. Look how pretty that is.
Look, I'm gonna get a few more mint leaves there. Then we're gonna take some of these crawfish tails.
Look how pretty.
And that's our fried Louisiana crawfish tail salad with a JD's molasses mustard Greek yogurt dressing.
Looks delicious. Cannot wait to dig in.
All right, now we gotta get a fork.
Field to Feast with Jennifer Finley was brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board, Louisiana Crawfish, Ask Before You Eat, and by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council, Beef, It's What's for Dinner, and by the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board, Think Rice.
If you'd like to try that recipe, and I don't know why you wouldn't want to try that, the best place to start is with some fresh Louisiana crawfish. So let's check some prices from around the state. In Church Point near David Savoy's farm, you can find live crawfish at Davis Seafood for $1.39 a pound and boiled for $3.33 a pound.
In Alexandria, Crawfish Port Incorporated has them live for $1.76 per pound. Boiled are $3.99 a pound.
In New Orleans, you can find some good prices at West Bank Seafood. You can get live crawfish for $1.29 a pound and boiled for $2.99 a pound. These crawfish prices are brought to you by our friends at the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board, which reminds you to always ask before you eat. Well, May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and we keep reminding you of this because a majority of farmers and farm workers say the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted their mental health, and more than half said they're personally experiencing more mental health challenges than they were a year ago, according to the American Farm Bureau's new poll. The agriculture industry as a whole has recognized the importance of having conversations and shining a light on this once taboo topic.
In this week's Twyla Boost, we're sharing a video from DeKalb Asgrow, which reminds us, while every farmer has faced difficult challenges, no one truly farms alone.
Actually, one of my best friends, Blake Cobb, he took his life last year, January 14th. No matter how bad a day he was having, you call him and gripe to him, tell him how crappy your day was. And, he was actually the guy that, said, hey, hang in there, things will get better. And just kind of scary to know that if a guy like that can do what he did, kind of makes you sit back and think it could happen to anybody. It really can. I wish I could have went back and told Blake, man, we're here. At the funeral there, how many friends, and I mean good friends, we just wish he had said something. And that's the problem with farmers. We have tons of pride. And Blake was no different. I mean, that's part of what makes farming exciting, I guess. Pride is a good thing in some aspects of life, but when it comes to saying you're a big, tough guy and you don't want to talk, keep everything bottled up, it don't do you any good. You gotta talk. It's the best thing to do. Everybody that has farmed has went through some kind of adversity before. So don't feel like you're the only person if it's struggling for money or losing ground or this and that. Everybody that farms has went through these same problems. Everybody. It will get better. I don't know if you got friends or not, but you got dealers, you got fertilizer guys that you can talk to. Preachers, there's tons of people. There's hotlines you can call. Talk to somebody. That's all I can tell you. There's plenty of people out there to talk. Just don't be afraid. It helped us, You can ask my wife and my kids. Since this happened, the farm used to be number one to me. And, now it's kids, wife, family, if the farm ain't gonna miss me when I'm gone, but the kids will, the wife will. So life will go on without that farm. My life won't go on with the family. So find out pretty quick what's important.
It's really important that we share these sorts of things with you because we want you here with us week after week after week, and mental health awareness and care are very important.
And if you're struggling yourself, we have some links that we've attached on our website at twylatv.org. Well, that does it for this edition of Twyla. Be sure to join us next week when we check in on Louisiana soybean farmers who are still trying to get their crop planted.
Yeah, it's a bit wet out there. Until then, you can watch all of our stories online at twylatv.org. And be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.
For all of us here at Twyla, thanks for joining us. We hope to see you again right here next week.